Good morning.
Good morning.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Welcome to the Forest Park Seventh-day Adventist Church. We're glad that you can join us either here in person or online. And if you are looking for a church family, we'd love to have you. And it's a beautiful Sabbath day, and this week was Thanksgiving. We had a lot to be thankful for. Amen?
Amen.
So, if you do plan on attending in person, please contact Kathy and let her know that you are planning on coming, because we are limited to approximately 50 people. So keep that in mind if you plan on attending. And looks like the school is collecting some stuff for Christmas baskets. If you can help with that, that would be greatly appreciated. Also, the Forest Park School will be having a Christmas program. It's going to be online only, so should be able to find that Thursday, December the 17th online. And Pastor Ryan has something he'd like to talk to us about.
Some of you probably heard that the Supreme Court made a
ruling. Testing, there we are. All right, some of you probably heard that the Supreme Court on Thanksgiving made a ruling regarding religious liberty. Now, it's important to notice that that was a specific ruling regarding a specific executive order out of the state of New York. And so that ruling does not apply to us here. And the issue there in New York was that businesses were given much more leeway and freedom than churches were under the order, and so there was an imbalance in the executive order, and that was considered to be a religious liberty violation. The Supreme Court has, however, upheld executive orders that do provide balance towards religious organizations regarding their ability to meet together as it pertains to, you know, all other aspects of society. So here in Washington State, we are not just free to throw off the governor's orders and congregate in mass just because we are a church. The virus doesn't really seem to care about that sort of thing. So we do still need to respect the executive order that is in place. So thank you all for being here this morning. Thank you for signing up, and thank you for wearing your masks, and still, given the most recent executive order, thank you for silently listening to the music in your head instead of singing along. Happy Sabbath.
Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this beautiful Sabbath day, even though there's a little rain out there and some clouds. We are still grateful and blessed to have a Sabbath and the opportunity to come and worship you. Thank you for all your many gifts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Today's scripture is Luke chapter 7, chapter 17, verses 11 through 19. And if you would like to follow along, I will be reading from the New King James Version, starting in verse 11. Now it happened, as he went to Jerusalem, that he passed through the midst of Samaria and Galilee. Then, as he entered a certain village, there met him 10 men who were lepers, who stood afar off. And they lifted up their voices and said, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." So when he saw them, he said to them, "Go, show yourselves to the priests." And so it was that as they went, they were cleansed. And one of them, when he saw that he was healed, returned and with a loud voice glorified God and fell down on his face at his feet, giving him thanks. And he was a Samaritan. So Jesus answered and said, "Were there not 10 cleansed? But where are the 9? Were there not any found who returned to give glory to God except for this foreigner?" And he said to him, "Arise, go your way. Your faith has made you well." May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. And now's the time where we petition the Lord. And all those who are able may kneel or take a reverent position wherever you're at. Our kind, loving Heavenly Father, we come before you to give you thanks, honor, and glory for your wonderful love and protecting care through another week. We thank you for all the many blessings that you've given us this year. We've had an opportunity this week to think about those things and ponder them. We pray for those that are sick. We pray for your healing hand according to your loving mercies. We pray for those that are grieving the loss of a loved one. We ask for the Holy Spirit to be with those people, especially in comforting them. We have many thanks for still having the freedom and opportunity to worship, even though it may be online at home or even to come and gather in this place. Continue to be with us. Open our hearts and our minds as Pastor Ryan opens the word and shares what you want us to hear today. Bless him. May his words be your words. Pray all these things in Jesus, our Lord and Savior's name, and for his soon return. Amen.
I must admit, it feels a little bit strange to be here at only about 13 past the hour, but with us not really being able to do much congregational singing, I suppose it makes sense. So here we are. Happy Thanksgiving Sabbath, friends. I'm so glad that each one of you is here. Welcome to all of those who are online worshiping with us this morning, and I just invite you once again, bow your heads with me for a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we give you thanks and praise for Jesus. Lord, we thank you for the gift of your Son at the cross. We thank you that even though we are completely unable to do anything about our own condition. The blood of Jesus is all sufficient to save us. Lord, as we gather together today to focus on your word, to worship together, I ask that your Holy Spirit would be here. I ask that you'd fill me with your spirit. Hide me in the shadow of your cross. Let these words be yours and not mine. In the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. In February of 1988, the BBC television show That's Life ran a 50-year-old story of extraordinary heroism, and they revealed it to the world. It all started on a Christmas trip to Prague in the year 1938. The young English stockbroker named Nicholas Winton had gone to Prague with a friend to see the refugee camps of Jews who had been displaced under the Nazi regime. While in his hotel room, he was bombarded with parents who kept coming and asking, "Can you get my child out of this country? Can you get my child to safety?" Parent after parent after parent. You see, they knew what was coming with the Nazis. And so, Nicholas Winton started calling nation after nation. He was writing letters to anyone who he could find, any person in an embassy, any ambassador, any State Department. He was writing letters. "Will you take in the refugees?" And only his own country, Great Britain, the United Kingdom, was willing to take the children. So he compiled a long list of children, and he went back to the UK with their names and their faces, and he found sponsors for them. And they had to have the money in hand and a signed documentation saying, "Yes, we will take this particular child," for them to be able to cross the border. And he went there and he loaded all of these children onto a train and took them across to the English Channel, where they loaded onto a boat. And they sailed to Great Britain, and then these children were delivered to their host families. Then he returned and did it again and again, until a total of 669 Jewish children had been evacuated from Prague, Czechoslovakia, just prior to the Nazi invasion. Nearly every one of those children lost their parents in the Holocaust. Within weeks, if not months, certainly within years, they were orphans in the truest sense. And then after it was no longer possible to go back to Prague to save more children, Nicholas Winton joined the RAF and defended his nation in the Battle of Britain. More than 40 years went by from this heroic act. No one really knew anything about it, except those who had been involved. That is, until Nicholas Winton's wife, who he was not married at the time of this act, she found in the attic, in a trunk in the attic, a big scrapbook with all of the children's names, their pictures, and who they had gone to. She confronted him about it. "Dearest husband, what is this thing that I am finding in the attic?" Knowing that he could not escape the story, he revealed all to her, everything that he had done. Well, she was not content to let this act of heroism go unnoticed, and so she sent the scrapbook to the press, and the press got a hold of it, and eventually the BBC got a hold of it, and they did a feature on this exact thing. Unbeknownst to him, they invited Nicholas Winton to the airing of this show on BBC, but he didn't know that there were many of those children in the audience that day. You can watch it on YouTube. Google it. I promise you. Sir Nicholas Winton, put it in. If it doesn't move you to tears, something's turned off in here. You see, he's sitting there, and the host of the show says, "How many of you here today owe your life to Nicholas Winton?" And 30 or so people right behind him stand up. These were the children, now adults, who had been evacuated on these trains. In the interviews that I watched, it was interesting to me that Sir Nicholas Winton, because the Queen heard about it and knighted him, Sir Nicholas Winton always downplayed what he had done, and he always expressed regret that they were not able to get the next train out. You see, they had another 251 children with sponsors in the UK when the Nazis invaded. And at that point, they were unable to go back. Nearly every one of those children certainly perished. That's what he focuses on, the ones that he couldn't do anything for. In our story for today, we find 10 lepers who are miraculously healed by Jesus himself. But in an interesting turn of events, only one of these 10 now healed lepers comes back to say thank you, to express their gratitude to Jesus. So I invite you, open your Bibles again to Luke chapter 17, verses 11 through 19. So Luke chapter 17, verses 11 through 19. Let's read it again together. Hear the word of the Lord. On the way to Jerusalem, he was passing along between Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers who stood at a distance and lifted up their voices, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. And he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus answered, "Were not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" And he said to him, "Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well." In order to understand the importance of this story, first we need to pay a little bit of attention to geography. Verse 11 tells us that Jesus was passing along between Samaria and Galilee. Samaria was the area west of the Jordan River between the region of Galilee in the north and Judea in the south. It was faster if you were traveling from Galilee to Judea, as Jesus often was, to go on the west side of the Jordan River, but that would take you through Samaria. It appears that this is what Jesus was doing, because the longer route meant you had to cross the Jordan River, travel on the east side of the Jordan River all the way south to Jericho, cross the Jordan River again, and then take the journey up into Jerusalem. But there was a reason that most Jews took the longer route. It was because of prejudice. You see, in that time, the Jews had no dealings with Samaritans. That's why it was so scandalous in the story we find in John chapter 4, when Jesus sat down at a well and started conversing with a Samaritan woman. The disciples could barely handle this. What is Jesus doing? But Jesus is in the business of destroying prejudice. Not only did Jesus minister to that woman there, but he ministered to the entire town, that entire Samaritan town. Now, I think Jesus was on purpose traveling this direction on this particular day, on the border between Galilee and Samaria, because he was up to something. Now, the other important piece of information for us to understand is the nature of leprosy. Leprosy was nothing to joke at. The entire chapter of Leviticus 13, which is 59 verses. I read it this week. It took me a little while. And about halfway through, I thought to myself, why am I reading this whole thing? I've already read this before. It's a long long chapter. And it's devoted to leprosy, how the priests were to diagnose it, and how it was to be dealt with. So if a person got a spot on their skin, that was bad. Perhaps the husband says to the wife, does that look abnormal to you? And she'll go, yeah, it does look weird. Stay away from me. You better go show yourself to the priest. And so the person would go and show himself to the priest. And the priest would say, yeah, you've got a spot on your skin. So now we're going to quarantine you for 7 days. Does that sound familiar to anyone? Quarantining for 7 days? Yes. So the priest quarantines the man. I don't know exactly how they did this, because he probably couldn't return to his house. They probably had special places where they did this. But the man was quarantined for 7 days. Now, if the spot stayed the same or got worse, he was pronounced unclean. But if it got better, if it, you know, started to heal, then he was pronounced clean. The difference between these two is enormous. If the man was pronounced unclean, he never got to go home. Think about that. He never got to go home. He never again got to embrace his family. He had to cover his mouth like this as he walked down the streets, and he had to yell out with a loud voice, unclean, unclean, so that everyone would get out of his way. And then he had to go and be at a great distance from people. The plight of the leper was terrible. Oftentimes, they congregated in communities, leper colonies. Why? Because their common fate, this slow death sentence, bonded them together. You see, even lepers crave human contact. This is something we're craving right now in our COVID times. Even lepers craved human contact, and so the best they could do was to congregate with other lepers. And then their families would bring them food. The family member would come out to the leper colony, but they had to stay a long ways off, and the kind of an unofficial understanding of the distance was about 50 yards or 150 feet that you had to stay separated from people. You think 6 feet's a long ways, try 150. And they would come and they would set the food about 150 feet away from the leper colony, and they could wave. And then they had to turn and leave so that their loved one could come and get the food. That's all before the disease itself. You see, leprosy was an aggressive, chronic ailment of the skin. Today it is known as Hansen's disease, according to the World Health Organization. And left untreated, it will eat away at the flesh until it causes disability, disfigurement, and even death. To be pronounced unclean by the priest was a death sentence. Kind of like if you hear today you have pancreatic cancer. This is a death sentence, although this one killed you a lot slower than pancreatic cancer. Today, leprosy, Hansen's disease, is treatable. In Jesus' day, it was a slow and lonely way to die. And so, standing a long way off as Jesus entered the town, those words are very significant to us, standing a long way off, the lepers called out together, Jesus, Lord, Master, have mercy on us. Implied is, we don't want to die this way. We want to go home to our families. Have mercy on us. Immediately understanding their plight, Jesus replies to them, go and show yourselves to the priests. This response was consistent with the Levitical law. You see, if the person's spot got better after they had leprosy, if they had been pronounced unclean and sent away, but a month or two later, it started to heal, and it got better, the person, still proclaiming unclean as they went, could go back to the priest, and the priest could re-examine it. And then the priest could say, well, now I must quarantine you for another 7 days, and quarantine them again. And if it continued to be better, the priest could pronounce them clean. In fact, if they were totally clean, they didn't necessarily have to do the quarantine again. They could just be pronounced clean. And so as the 10 lepers went, in accordance with the command of Jesus, to show themselves to the priests, who alone could pronounce them clean, they were healed. Amen. Those 10 lepers, each and every one of them, was healed. But then the text says, then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice, and he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. Remember, Jews had no dealings with Samaritans. The disciples were probably uncomfortable that Jesus was traveling near the region of the Samaritans. In fact, the Jewish prejudice against the Samaritans was palpable, perhaps even into the realms of hatred. The fact that it was a Samaritan who came back to give thanks to Jesus is kind of a way of heaping burning coals on their heads. One commentator on this passage aptly said, how those often prove most grateful from whom it was least expected. I've often told people, and it was Aaron and I's experience as well, that when you get married, you'll learn who your real friends are. Some of you chuckle. During the hustle and bustle leading up to our wedding, several people emerged as extraordinarily helpful and kind. People that I would not have previously anticipated being so kind and helpful. Others who I thought would have been much more involved, given the invitations extended to them, the positions at our service extended, found reasons not to be all that involved. To me, those actions revealed the character underneath. But thank God people can change, because several of these people have changed, and very much for the better. In acknowledging the Samaritan's gratitude, Jesus is reinforcing the idea that salvation is for everyone. But oftentimes, the people that you expect to be the first to sign up and respond do not. And some of the people who you think are the last ones who would respond are, in fact, the first ones to be there. But salvation is for everyone. No one is excluded. Any prejudices that we may have towards one group or type of person or another, those need to be checked at the door. If ever our attitudes or feelings that God loves one kind of person more than another, maybe it's because of their choices or their life circumstance or, heaven forbid, the color of their skin. Any prejudice like that will probably find us on the outside of salvation looking in rather than on the inside looking out. Check the prejudice at the door. It's one of the messages Jesus gives us here in this parable. Now, the fact that only 1 in 10 came back to thank Jesus, to me, reveals what was going on the inside for these men. The inside. Keep in mind, they all cried out for mercy in a loud voice. Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. They probably shouted together to make sure that they were heard. And all of them received mercy. All 10. How many in our world today are crying out for mercy? Quite a few, isn't it? Right now with COVID, how many people are crying out for mercy to God? God, relieve us of the COVID. Have mercy on us. It should be no surprise that when things are going badly, people seek God with a different sense of urgency. Right after 9/11, church attendance across our nation soared. The Seventh-day Adventist Church in the year 2002, the year right after 9/11, had a record number of baptisms here in North America. Church attendance was high. But by 2003, you know what happened across the nation? Church attendance went back to the same old, same old. Many people cried out for mercy under those extraordinary circumstances. But when God brought mercy, when God answered the request that was given, what happened to those people? Only one came back. When people are confronted by circumstances totally out of their control, when they have to grapple with their own powerlessness, they tend to be much more reliant on God. And when people cry out to God for mercy, God listens, and He oftentimes grants mercy. Let's not miss that point. God oftentimes grants mercy when people cry out for mercy. But when things are going well again, have to put that word again on there. When things are going well again, when deliverance or healing has taken place, how quickly do we turn away from God? One came back to give thanks. You see, the inner condition of the heart is revealed once God answers the petition. It becomes apparent that what the people really wanted from God was for Him to relieve their suffering so they could get back to their lives. God, relieve our suffering so we can go back to doing what makes us happy. Relieve our suffering so we can get back to the status quo. Relieve our suffering so we can go back to serving ourselves. You see, they have no real interest in God, but only what God can do for them. I don't believe that it's any coincidence that just 10 verses before this parable, or the story of the 10 lepers, we find the parable of the rich man and Lazarus. Now, hopefully you remember the phrase that I like so much. It goes something like this: a text without a context is merely a pretext to a proof text. Just a few verses before this story of the 10 lepers, we have a story about faith. And Jesus says, if you have faith like a mustard seed, you can move mountains. Right before that is the parable of the rich man and Lazarus. Now, if you don't remember that parable, let me summarize it really quickly for you. There, in the afterlife, we find Lazarus with Father Abraham in glory, and the rich man is being tormented in a place known as Hades. This is not a description of what hell is like. This is a parable to teach a lesson, so keep that in mind. Come to the same conclusion Jesus does in this parable. The rich man goes, Father Abraham, how come I'm here, and Lazarus is there with you? And Father Abraham says, rich man, in life you had many good things. Lazarus had many poor things. You have received all that you will ever get in life. He now is receiving his due in eternity. In essence, implied is you did not care for this man. You did not do anything kind for him. You did not use the wealth and the good that you had to care for your poorer brother. So you are now in torment there. Father Abraham, will you please send Lazarus to dip his finger in the water and come and cool my tongue, for I am in torment here in these flames. And Father Abraham replies, an endless chasm has been fixed between us. We cannot cross over. It is irreversible. How many want what God offers without a relationship with God Himself? How many want to be on the correct side of the chasm in eternity, but they don't really want the God who is on that side? They don't want His self-sacrificing love, the kind of love that would cause them to care for a poor beggar at their gate. 10 verses after this parable, 10 verses, we find the 10 lepers. They're cleansed, and only one comes back to give thanks. You see, friends, how we cry out to God when things are going badly is no real indicator of faith. because nearly everyone cries out to God when things are going badly. As the old adage goes, there are no atheists in foxholes. There are no atheists in foxholes. When it's going bad, people cry out to God. That's not a bad thing. In fact, I would say it's a good and natural thing to call out to God in those situations. But the real indicator of faith is how we cry out to God when things are going well again. How do we respond to God when He has restored us, when He has answered our petition? Real faith lifts its voice in praise and thanksgiving to God under those circumstances. Real faith turns around to thank God first, even before going and showing oneself to the priest to be pronounced clean. That's real faith. When they saw that they had been healed, only one returned to Jesus and cried out in praise and thanksgiving. The text says he was praising God with a loud voice. He fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving thanks to Him. The fact that Jesus commends this response and that Luke is inspired by the Holy Spirit to include it in the gospel indicates the kind of ongoing, continuous relationship that Jesus wants with us. He wants us to come repeatedly, over and over, day after day, to fall down at His feet and give Him praise and give Him thanksgiving for what He has done for us. Jesus wants to know us, to be near to us, to walk with us, to talk with us. He wants to be included in each aspect of our lives. I'd like to tell you the story about a woman named Wendy. Wendy is the wife of the man I worked for, I was grad assistant for, while I was studying my master's degree back at the seminary. And when I was taking a class from her husband, one day she came into our class and gave her testimony. You see, Wendy and Alan had married a little bit later in life, second marriage for both of them. And Alan had been promoted. He had become one of the conference office big shots, you know, one of the big wigs from the conference, and had achieved all that could really be achieved as far as, you know, pastoral ministry and these things were going. And she thought to herself, God, isn't there more than this? Don't you want more from us than this? And she felt impressed. She made the commitment to get up at 5 a.m. every morning until she could answer the question with certainty that she knew God. And she told us in that class, after her whole body language changed, her face softened, smile emerged, it was the best decision I ever made. The best decision I ever made. God, don't you want more? Isn't there more? Isn't there more? In verse 19, Jesus says to the man, "Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well." None of the other lepers were given this commendation. It would seem that this man now had something the others did not. And I submit to you this morning that this man's faith led to his eternal salvation. Whereas with the others, that's a question mark for us. In my English Standard Version of the Bible here, there's a footnote accompanying verse 19, which gives us an alternate reading to this text. It goes like this: your faith has saved you. Let's talk about that for just a minute. The Greek word here is the word sozo. Now, the Greek word sozo, when I learned it as a vocabulary word, studying Greek at Walla Walla University, meant to save. It did not mean to heal, it meant to save. But then when you get into more advanced levels of Greek, you learn that each word, kind of like in English, can have multiple senses in which it can be used. And another sense that it can be used as is to heal. Your faith has healed you. Your faith has made you whole. Your faith has saved you. All of these ideas are present in this one word here. Now, let's look at a parallel story really quickly in Mark chapter 5, where Jesus makes a very similar pronouncement. Your faith has made you well. In Mark chapter 5, we find the story of the woman who touched the garment of Jesus. You remember this story? The crowd is pressed around Jesus. Jesus is going to the home of Jairus, who is a well-known, well-to-do man. His daughter is very sick. In fact, they get word that his daughter has died, and Jesus keeps on going. And the crowd is pressing around him because the streets aren't all that wide. And so as Jesus is moving, this woman is like, how can I get close to Jesus? How can I get close to Jesus? If all I can do is just touch the fringe of his garment, I know that I'll be healed. And so she works her way around, and finally he gets close enough, and she reaches for it, touches the fringe of his garment, and instantly she's healed. Jesus stops. Who touched me? Master. Everyone's touching you. It's a narrow street. There's hundreds of people here. Everybody's touching you. No. Someone touched me. Who touched me? Knowing that she could not conceal herself, the woman showed herself, it was me. What does Jesus say to her? Daughter, your faith has made you well. Sozo. Go in peace and be healed of your disease. Two separate ideas are included here, aren't they? Your faith has made you well. Your faith has saved you. Go in peace and be healed of your disease. You see, when Jesus brings healing, physical healing, it's his desire also to bring spiritual healing. And the response of faith brings salvation to our lives. The response of faith brings salvation. Jesus tells her that her faith has made her well, just exactly the same way he says to the leper in Luke chapter 17, and be healed of your disease. So I posit to you this morning, when Jesus says to the leper in Luke 17, your faith has made you well, that he is in fact saying, your faith has brought salvation to your life. Your faith has saved you. You see, friends, Jesus didn't die on the cross just so he could cure COVID. In fact, he doesn't need to die on the cross to cure COVID. He didn't die on the cross so he could cure cancer. He didn't die on the cross so he could stop a war. He didn't die on the cross to prevent abuse or all of the other terrible things that happen in our lives. That's not why Jesus died on the cross. Jesus died on the cross so he could take away our sin. When Jesus was preaching in a house one day, several friends brought their paralyzed friend to him. And they opened up the roof and they lowered him down. And Jesus said, son, your sins are forgiven. Everyone was scandalized. Jesus is claiming to be God. Only God can forgive sins. But then he says something very important for us to wrestle with. Which is easier for Jesus to say, your sins are forgiven? Or rise, take up your bed and walk? Which is easier for God? Which do you think? It's not rise, take up your bed, and walk. Jesus didn't die to cure things like that. Jesus had to die so that he could cleanse us from sin. You see, it's easy for us to get focused on external things in our lives, isn't it? Very, very easy for us. But it's much harder for us to realize that each and every one of us is terminally infected with the sin, or the leprosy of sin. Each one of us has that leprosy. And just like the leper was banished away from their home, away from their family, because of our sin, we are banished away from the eternal kingdom. And only the blood of Jesus can pronounce us clean. Only the blood of Jesus can give us admission into that kingdom. And I promise you, friend, on that day, you don't want to be like Lazarus staring across the fixed chasm saying, but I wanted to be in there. Only the blood of Jesus gets us there. And he asks that we come back and we cultivate a relationship with him, that we give him thanks and that we give him praise, that we get to know him. You see, whether we are multimillionaires who seem to have the perfect family, live in big houses, have nice jobs, drive nice cars, and go on expensive vacations, or whether we're poor, live paycheck to paycheck in a small apartment, we're chronically ill, going from job to job, and life more or less kind of stinks. Regardless of which side we're on, we all need Jesus. Every single one of us. We may be confused in this life, oh, I have it so good, everything is going so well, and think, maybe I don't need Jesus after all. Wrong, friend. We do need Jesus. In an eternal sense, neither the rich nor the poor can save themselves. We are all still banished from eternity without the blood of Jesus Christ. You see, friends, sin is irrespective of social standing. It does not care about the size of our bank account, the country we were born into, the church that we were born into. Does not care. Sin affects us all. We all need Jesus. Now, keeping in mind that a text without a context is merely a pretext to a proof text, I would be remiss if I did not point out what came next, right after this passage in Luke chapter 17. Right after Jesus says to this one who came back, "Rise, go your way, your faith has made you well," he launches into a sermon about the signs of his second coming. How are we to be prepared for the second coming? It's not by meticulously understanding everything that the Pope is doing, but it's by being bowed down at the feet of Jesus, giving him thanks and praise for what he has done for us. That is the response that is anticipated. And I believe this text calls for response. This story of the 10 lepers is a call to action. So, what about you, friend? What is your response to the invitation of Jesus? Perhaps you're a young person who's been part of the church since your childhood, and you sense that it is now time to make faith your own. It's no longer just the faith of my family, the faith that I grew up in, but it is my faith. Maybe it is your turn to commit your life to Jesus Christ. Perhaps you were raised in the faith a good long while ago and you have left for whatever reason, and you sense that it's time to come home. Is Jesus calling you to come home today? Perhaps you're new to the whole faith journey and you have never committed your life to Jesus Christ. The Spirit is impressing you perhaps to do that today. Perhaps you've never left the church, but in your heart you know that your spiritual commitment left a long time ago, that you've not taken these things as seriously as you ought to. For you, perhaps it is time to recommit yourself. Today, decide. The question comes to you. Now, I'm not one to make altar calls and invite people to stand up and come forward, and in fact, with COVID, it probably wouldn't be a great idea to do something like that. But I do have to say, we can't make a decision like this in isolation. When we make a decision to give our life to Jesus, to give our life back to Jesus, we need to reach out and to tell someone. I know when I decided to get baptized, I was at a week of prayer at Auburn Academy, and I had gone to the evening presentation because there was dorm students there. We had a morning and an evening worship, so the speaker got to speak like 10 or 11 times during the week. And as a village student, I had come back to campus for the evening presentation of Week of Prayer. And I remember this. I don't even remember what the speaker said. I don't remember who the speaker was. And I'm pretty sure they didn't make an altar call. But I remember being convicted in my heart, now is the time for you to make the decision to follow me. You need to go and to tell, and a good pastor friend of mine was there, you need to go tell Pastor Jay that you want to study and get baptized. You need to make that choice. Perhaps someone is being impressed by the Holy Spirit to do that. We cannot make this choice in isolation, friends. We must reach out and tell someone. So if that's you today, come find me, call me this week, talk to one of the elders. Tell someone. Tell someone. God will honor that decision. Will you pray with me this morning? Lord, we love you so much. And as we consider the things that you have done for us, the way that you left heaven and came to this earth, knowing that each one of us was doomed to destruction under the curse of sin, and that you took on humanity, and you went to the cross, and that you died there for us. We are so grateful. We are so thankful. Lord, let us be that one who came back, the one who recognized what you have done for us, and we're not content to do anything else until we had bowed down at your feet and given you thanks and given you praise. Lord, we ask that praise and thanksgiving would be on our lips. And we are especially thankful for your gift of salvation. Lord, if there's someone here today, perhaps someone watching online, who you are impressing to make that decision, perhaps for the first time, perhaps for renewal, I ask that you would strongly impress on them the need to reach out and to tell someone. I ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
To do, and God's soft prompting. that's where you belong.
And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.